What's going on, guys? What's going on, guys? Welcome to the My Parents Office podcast. I am your host, Andrew Diaz. Today we got episode 108. I am joined by my co-host and producer, Brett, via Zoom, down in New Jersey. Today we've got the sports movies draft on the last episode on 106. So go check that out if you haven't already. So today we're going to kind of follow that up and do a sports documentaries draft about our favorite, pretty much just our favorite sports docs that have been out, revolving around the sports world, different scandals, feel good stories, stuff like that. But before we do that, socials at My Parents Office on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, My Parents Office podcast Facebook page, and Substack articles from the office. Started a new series. I'm giving out my my gambling picks for the week for college football. I put my three out. We're taping this Wednesday, so my picks are out now. Go check those out. I've got one lock of the week, which is with the spread. I've got a over-under game and then another game with the spread. So definitely go check those out if you're into sports gambling and college football in general. Take the picks. I'm not a gambling expert. Nowhere near it, so don't blame me if you lose your house. But other than that, Brett, what's going on?
What's up, buddy? I like that idea a lot, actually.
Found a website that gives you all the different lines for the week. It gives you like a bunch of different websites that give you the lines too, so you can go off different ones. But I'm using the FanDuel ones for it, so we'll see how it goes. See what my record turns out to be.
I believe in you.
I appreciate the belief, but. So we have the results from the sports movie draft. I believe I won. Let me make sure that I'm not bluffing right now. So I won 74-26. Brett, it was a trouncing.
Okay, well, they have no taste.
No taste. So with that being said, I'll have the number one pick for the documentary draft.
Before we start, I already know how that's going to go because – the other one was narratives. They were features. I can enjoy a feature for football, basketball, something in that world that really has nothing to do with the sport itself.
Yep.
Documentary. You have to like a little bit more of that sport, I think, if you enjoy the documentary.
Oh yeah, no, I've got a couple. I did my homework on it. I made sure I had the ones, and like I'm not doing that. Like I'll go my number one pick. I'm going to take athlete A for it about the Larry Nassar scandal, which it's a really great documentary and it really doesn't revolve around like the sport of gymnastics. But the gymnastics is pretty much what brought Larry Nassar together with these gymnasts. So that's my number one pick. And it was a great documentary. I watched that when it first came out with my dad and we were like, you're baffled that what's most disgusting in it is, honestly, the way the parents act in it, because the parents essentially keep the kids quiet. It's not just Michigan State Athletics or Larry Nassar or USA Gymnastics. The parents are like, no, you've trained your whole life to make this team. You're like, don't say anything. Like, you're fine. This isn't happening. You're lying. And it turns out that Nassar ended up molesting an unreal amount of girls. It's one of the craziest sports stories I think ever. That was a really good documentary. It's a tough one to watch because of like it's a pretty graphic one too when they talk about the crimes he committed. So but athlete A is going to be my number one overall pick for the draft. Brett, where are we going with number two overall?
Okay. I'm gonna have to go with Icarus.
Icarus.
Yeah, the one where about the Russia taking steroids in 2016 at the Olympics.
How do you spell that?
I-C-A-R-U-S.
I've never seen this one.
Yeah, it's on Netflix. It goes pretty deep. Pretty much the dude who revealed the secrets of Russia is in hiding because he's on like their most wanted. But it's pretty much about how throughout all the Olympic sports, Russia pretty much tampered with all the pee samples. And it's just, I mean, that's the reason why Russia didn't participate as Russia this year.
It was what, like, team, what were they called? Like,
their Russian Olympic Committee.
Yes, that's what it was. The ROC.
It's the world's biggest slap on the wrist of all time.
Oh, it's ridiculous that they were even able to put athletes
it's
in.
It's hilarious.
And like, I understand. I can sympathize with the athletes that didn't take steroids, and like, they should be able to compete, but I don't agree that they should. Like, you say they should, like, it's different, it's individual, but I mean, if your whole country, and it's not like one or two guys were taking steroids.
No, it was state, you had to, it was state sponsored. No, so I have sympathy for the ones that did take them as well, because it's not like even the wrestlers, which, no bias here, there's wrestlers in the documentary, like, some of them definitely juiced a little bit, but I sympathize, because it's not like, I don't know, maybe I just respect them too much, but
yeah,
to me, I wouldn't think that it was like their idea or they would want to do that kind of thing. But
it is crazy that it's state sponsored. Like, it wasn't like a trainer going behind the back of like coaches and supplying the athletes with steroids. It was literally Russia was going with it, which is crazy. It's outrageous.
Yeah. But if you want to learn more about that, watch Icarus.
100%. I think I'll probably watch that this weekend. That actually, you said it's on Netflix?
It is on Netflix, yeah.
Looks good. What, Lance Armstrong's in it?
Yeah.
One of the guys in it, his name is Dick Pound.
Richard?
That's a tough name to have growing up if you're a kid having the name Dick.
Why would you go by Dick? He knows, he's in on the joke at that point.
And it's not like it says Richard Pound. Like, I was like,
no, exactly.
His name is on the thing, because he's like one of the like top, it shows like big cast members. And it's like, it says like Lance Armstrong and right next to it, Dick Pound.
That's incredible. That's tremendous.
Yeah. Mr. and Mrs. Pound.
I know we still got a few to go, but do you know any good soccer documentaries? Because that's the sport Zoe is with, and I don't know shit. So
there's a few good 30 for 30s. That's actually where I'm kind of dipping my toe into. There's one, the two Escobars about Andres Escobar and Pablo Escobar. And that is that kind of, but that's not a lot of soccer. It like soccer is in it, but it's about a lot more than soccer. If you go on ESPN though and do the 30 for 30s and do the soccer search, there's a lot of good ones on there. Going back to like the 80s and 90s of soccer too. So those, you could definitely find some good ones on there.
Yeah, I need some research.
So number three overall, my second pick, I'm going to go with one that came out earlier than it was supposed to because of COVID. People were clamoring over it. I wasn't sure how I was going to like it. But I'm going to go Last Dance. And in reality, it's kind of posed as a Jordan documentary, but it's more about the Bulls. About six or seven parts are probably about Jordan, but then there's ones about Pippen, Scott Burrell, who's a Connecticut guy. Kerr. They talk about his dad getting killed. You learn a lot, and especially the era, I think a lot of people that were older that went through it maybe weren't a fan of the documentary, but I never lived through that Jordan era. Kids my age and our generation never lived through that Jordan era. Maybe some of them were old enough to remember him on the Wizards, but none of us lived through that Bulls dynasty. And Jordan's dad getting killed was a huge storyline in it. Jordan being an asshole teammate. Dennis Rodman kind of being this wild man that they would literally send on vacation during the season so he could party, and then he'd show up and still get 25 or 30 rebounds in a game and no points, but he did his job. It was one of the most dysfunctional teams of all time that somehow found their way and became functional, which is, it's a weird way to put it, but they had their own style of how they were going to do things. And if any other team had tried to do what they did, where they send their wild man on vacation to booze up for 2 days and then come back to play against the Milwaukee Bucks, no one would be able to do it. Or if you had a guy that ruled with an iron fist like Jordan did, no other team would be able to do that with their teammates. Jordan was just on a different level. So really being able to see that, and it had a sweet soundtrack too. There was a lot of Outkast in it, a lot of old 80s, 90s music, and kind of seeing Jordan play in college too. Some of that footage was really cool. My big complaint though was the whole flu game one was such bullshit. Like, I just think Jordan was smoking cigars every minute he got. I don't think he ate like a tampered pizza the night of the flu game or the night before. I think he smoked a cigar or he was just shit-faced hungover. There's no way he ate just a pizza and became sick by that. So
my one calling the goat a liar? Overall,
a good documentary.
Calling the goat a liar?
I am calling the goat a liar. Not like
calling him out on the bad one.
I think it's like the whole thing. Paul Pierce had this where he was wheelchaired off the court during a game and he came back in and like I think hit the game winning shot. And then he admitted a few years later after he retired that all he had to do was shit. And that's why he got wheelchaired off. And everyone was like, why would you say that? Like, you're literally tarnishing your legacy. So if Jordan ever came out and said that, like, he wasn't actually sick and didn't have the flu, that it was just like he was hungover or got sick from a cigar, that would tarnish not his whole legacy, but it would take away a little bit of the lore of Michael Jordan.
Michael Jordan, if you're hearing this, Andrew Diaz calling you a liar.
Yeah, get on the pod. I'm going to be in touch with MJ's people later. We'll have him on later in the week. It'll actually be a double episode. Him and JR Specs, two guests on very same level. So we'll have them on together.
Precise.
All right. Number four overall.
One more thing back in the documentary, Last Dance. I never actually did see that one yet, but I listened to a lot of podcasts when that was being popular or that when that first came out.
Yep.
Talked about it weekly at that point. And it's just crazy. Like, we talked about sports movies this week. Yes. It's crazy to think that that is a documentary, that's an actual nonfiction piece. Like, all those parts you just said, that's hard to believe that those actually happened. Those sound scripted.
I completely agree. And like, there's even some smaller parts, like Steve Kerr's dad was assassinated and like him and Jordan, kind of the only thing they really bonded over, because Jordan, there's the story, Jordan punched Steve Kerr in the face during practice. And there was never really a mutual like, hey, I'm sorry between the two of them. And the only thing I guess they really bonded over was the fact that Jordan's dad was killed and Kerr's dad was killed. And then you've got Jerry Krause that is really the big, he's the villain in it because he's trying to break up this team. And that was another thing I wasn't a huge fan of, is they're like slandering Jerry Krause, and Jerry Krause is dead. He can't really defend himself. Although he probably was the villain in this, I'm not a fan of absolutely shitting all over dead people when they're like don't have the ability to defend themselves.
50 Cent doesn't mind that.
yeah you're right.
You saw that?
Who was it he slandered? I know
the dude that just died from The Wire.
Did he really?
Yeah, I'll send that to you later.
Oh my god, wait, hang on. It's gotta be, if I type in 50 Cent as Michael K. Williams.
Yeah, it's incredible. It's hilarious.
What did he post?
The first thing was like pretty much just saying, like, he was just laughing about him like OD and like
damn, if you didn't see Raising Kanan, check it out. That fentanyl is no joke. Killing the clientele. RIP Michael K. Williams. Jesus.
That's Christ. Not even the first one, dude. He was saying, like, there are a couple others. It's hilarious.
Don't ever try to hang on. That was the first one that, like, hang on.
All right. Well, I saw a different
one. Send it to me later, but that was the first one that popped up. I'm like, oh, my God.
That's so funny.
That is fucking nuts. All right. Fourth overall pick. Swinging it over to Brett Castle. What are we rocking with?
Chasing Tyson.
That's a good one.
You saw that one? Yeah, okay. The documentary about Evander Holyfield, and even though for a long period of time he was champion, was not defeated – he was still always in the shadow of Mike Tyson. Tyson was locked up pretty much the whole time that Evander Holyfield was in prison. And throughout the whole time, they never really had respect for Holyfield because he hasn't beaten Tyson at that point. Even when he did beat Mike Tyson the first time, not the ear time, I don't know, people were like, well, it was a fluke. It was a fluke, that kind of thing, where he was supposed to fight him pretty early on, but he never got the chance because of the Buster Douglas loss in Japan.
Yep.
Beating Mike Tyson. But pretty much throughout all of Evander Holyfield's career, who arguably had a better like career loss to Mike Tyson, just not with those big flashy knockouts. He was just the Shield of Mike Tyson. Not Shield, Shadow.
Yeah, Tyson was like the flashy guy because, he, like you said, he's that big knockout type fighter.
He was problematic. He was always in the news, always raping, doing his thing.
It is kind of wild that like Tyson is now looked at like this
goofy,
cuddly figure.
Uncle Tyson. Uncle Mike.
He went to jail for rape. And, like, literally, you beat the shit out of Robin Givens.
Yeah. I mean, bit a couple ears.
Had this happened, like, in 2015, I think we would be seeing a very different Mike Tyson now versus the guy that's in Hangover and does, like, stand-up comedy.
Dude, his podcast is bad popular.
I don't think I could listen to him talk on a podcast.
It's incredible. You know, you listen to it for whoever he's with, from Jeremy Piven, Henry Cejudo.
It's kind of weird that him and Piven are boys too. Like, that's
crazy. It's incredible. It's so funny. I love that. It doesn't make sense at all.
Do you see? I think Piven started up a podcast.
Yeah, they're 14 episodes deep right now. His second episode with Lloyd just came out.
Have you listened to it at all? I haven't yet.
Yeah, I like it. Dude, it's my world. It's pretty much just MMA fighters, rappers, and Entourage characters. Like,
I guess a little off track, but I guess they talked about Lloyd pitching, like, he would get drunk at a party. It actually was kind of a funny idea. I mean, I don't think it would ever happen. How he was like, we should turn Entourage into, like, the Love Boat, pretty much. Which is hilarious, but, like, would literally never happen.
No, it's funny.
It is funny, though. I'll have to give that one a listen, though. I've been listening to Victory a little bit.
I need to buy some of their merch.
They have the Suits Suck one out, the shirt now?
Yeah, which it's just funny that was like, I think Billy Walsh was wearing that shirt in the show.
It's crazy. Like, I would have thought they would have had more Suits merch come out earlier.
Yeah, me too.
But.
Well, I feel like at first they had more merch for the podcast. So like Irish Crickets, Victory of the Podcast, and less Entourage itself.
Yeah. Yeah. But so Chasing Tyson, number 4 overall, second for you.
Yes, sir.
All right. Number 3, I'm going to stick to the world of basketball. One of my favorite, probably my favorite 30 for 30 of all time. If you're going to take Last Dance out of it, as a 30 for 30, it would be I Hate Christian Laettner, about the arguably one of the greatest college. You could put him in the contention for like greatest college basketball player of all time. And he was just hated. He was a dirty player, but was dirty within the rules because he wouldn't get really ejected. He would find sneaky ways to get at players, and he would get under their skin, and he had composure to not react and go off on guys. But he also was super clutch. He had the turnaround shot that's famous. But the big bummer is he never panned out in the NBA. But like, seeing how much a country can hate an athlete is wild. It's crazy how much America hated Christian Laettner and how one small town in the state of North Carolina loved this big white power forward that everybody hated and would just get under people's skin. And that documentary made me want to root. Like, if I were in that time, would make me want to root for Christian Laettner. But I know I would have hated him because he got into spats with UConn players. But it almost, after the fact, like after he's done playing, it makes you want to like him a little bit. But I know for a fact, I would have been screaming, I hate Christian Laettner at my TV watching him play against UConn. Because he was so good and just such a dick when he played. But he was a blue collar guy too. Oh, everything about him, you could hate him or either love him. There was no in between with a player like that. It seemed like one little town in North Carolina really, really loved the guy. So that's going to be my third overall pick. And it's great seeing like former players that he played against in college talk about how much they hated him too. And they still to this day, like hold a grudge against a guy like that. So it's awesome.
Go a little deeper. Like, why do people hate him so much?
Well, so it was part of the reason was because he was on Duke too. So Duke was good. And they were perceived as like this snooty, white, arrogant team. And like there were teams that were more likable, like the Fab Five of Michigan was kind of around that time with Chris Webber. And like they were a grittier team where they were a little bit flashier too. Like they were just a high flying team that everybody liked to watch. But this team, the Duke team, was just so technically sound that they would just wallop teams. They would literally be beating the shit out of teams and never take their foot off your neck. And Leitner became the captain of that team, pretty much. It was him and one of the Hurley brothers that really took over. And another thing that people don't like Leitner for is because he was also picked to the USA Olympic team, the dream team, over Shaquille O'Neal, because they could only pick one college player at the time. Him and Shaq were both in college, and they ended up picking Leitner over him, which is pretty crazy seeing how their careers were so very different. But I mean, if I'm looking at their roster right now, they had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That Duke team had 6 guys make the NBA, and a lot of them were good. I mean, Leitner wasn't great in the NBA. He didn't pan out, but you had Grant Hill, an all-time great player. You had Bobby Hurley, Brian Davis, Antonio Lang, and Cherokee Parks. So that whole team was just hated all around, and it was because of Duke, but Leitner just personified what Duke was, and did fucking teams hate him. Oh, my God, it was brutal. Like, arenas would pack the house. They would pack arenas just to yell at Leitner, pretty much. It's crazy.
That's crazy, especially for college.
Yeah, you forget he's like an 18, 19-year-old kid playing, and millions of people despise this kid, hate his guts.
That's a flex right there. I would actually love to be in that position.
Yeah, that it is pretty impressive that you can turn an entire country against you, and while also being like
committing a murder.
Yeah, and like the thing that's crazy too is he was also like he could back up his trash talk and dirty play. Like he averaged 21 points his senior year. I mean, he was a freak. All right. So number 6 overall for you? Your third pick, number 6 overall. What are you going with, Brett?
I don't know why they just came into my head, but I'm thinking another boxing one right now because it's just the first thing I thought of. The Triple G documentary, The Making of Triple G.
I haven't seen that one.
It's on DAZN.
What's it called? The Making of Triple G?
Correct. I don't think the word triple's in there, just GGG.
I wrote Triple G. I'm like, that wouldn't really make a lot
of sense. Yeah, it's the Gennady Golovkin documentary.
Yeah.
He's from Kazakhstan. Dude's a killer. Like, it's just, he's not a very intimidating figure just looking at him, but at the same time, he was just so small. I don't love boxing compared to the other martial arts that I care a lot about.
Right.
He's just that figure that's so smart, and he's just like, he has to prove himself being like the biggest guy, the fastest guy, but he knows what he's doing. But it's not like a documentary that's about his upbringing, about his childhood, like the hardships, that kind of thing. It's just him talking and a couple of professional, like sports boxing writers talking. Yep. He's how good he is and how people were intimidated to fight him and how powerful his weapons were. Meaning his arms, not a gun. But dude is a killer, and I definitely recommend that one.
That sounds. What's that? Where can people find that one?
DAZN, DAZN.
DAZN. Okay. Awesome. That's pretty cool. I definitely check that one out.
They have some good box documentaries. They have a good one of Anthony Joshua. There's some good stuff.
Hold up 1 second. I got a text. I'm helping a family friend out in the in a fantasy draft right now.
Oh, great.
So I he's on the clock, I think.
So I need to buy aloe for my face at some point.
Well, you got burnt to a crisp today. You got to send me a selfie later with it.
I'm a fucking tomato, dude.
Well, you went down to America's set like that. Like you live in the cesspool, but you
it went was, down it was to the beach in Boardwalk. You couldn't really go wrong with it. And she's tan, so like.
That's tough though, because I don't think you tan well.
Me now compared to when you first met me, I'm a lot more tan. But
Brett, you went from Casper to like mayonnaise.
My arms are bad. If you see under my shirt, I'm like a reflection. But listen, I just need to get burned a few times in order to get like one shade more tanner. So it's a process, dude.
Okay. I'll take your word for it.
Yeah.
So my next pick number seven. Wait, is that up? Yeah, pick number seven, my fourth pick. I'm going to go with actually another one about Duke. I'm going to go with Fantastic Lies. It's about the Duke lacrosse team and the whole scenario of when they were accused of rape by a prostitute. And it really became a huge debacle. The team was almost suspended. It was at an off-campus house. There were mixed stories about what happened. And I'm trying to describe it the best way I can, because it's an unreal documentary to think that it was another one that, like, wow, I can't believe all of this happened at one time. So I think the story is like the Duke lacrosse team had I think they bought a stripper or rented a stripper to come over to their house for like a party. She accused them of rape in like 2005, 2006. And it just, I think the allegation ended up becoming false and essentially ruined the lives of 5-6 lacrosse players individually. But the majority of the team had the reputation as like, you guys are rapists. Even though this didn't happen, you guys are still going to be branded as rapists. So it's nuts that this, like, another one that is just crazy that this happened. I mean, And not even the lacrosse team, though, it tarnished the school's reputation as well, of Duke being this like fraternity school where, like, if you're a girl there, you'll get raped. And like, that's pretty much what they bring up in the documentary. So that was a really good one. It was kind of eye opening too, much like the Larry Nassar one. I took number one, Athlete A. It's super eye opening and kind of at times you're like, wow, this is unreal. You don't expect you're going to get a lot of what you're going to get in this documentary. But I'm going to take that one number four, because it was just a real eye-opening one for me.
What's that one on?
That's a 30 for 30, an ESPN one.
Yeah, they do a great job.
They really do. There's some that miss, but majority of the time they hit real good. And they find good stories too, like ones that are somewhat underreported on or haven't had a documentary about.
Yeah, it's not like one of those things where they have like the same template for multiple stories. They do a great job.
Right. And like a really good one they did was they did the U and the U part two. It was about the Miami football team. And it literally, they split it up from like the 80s, 90s to like so that was the first one. And then part two was like late 90s to mid 2000s. And they did an unreal job of it. And you heard footage and saw pictures of like, and kind of when I'm watching like the one from the 2000s, I'm like, holy shit, I didn't realize he played for Miami at the time. Oh my God, this guy was an all pro. This guy was a pro bowler. This is crazy. And it's really eye-opening because you're like, wow, I didn't know this. You learn a lot when you're watching the 30 for 30s, which I think is pretty cool.
Yeah.
All right. Eighth overall, fourth pick. You've got Icarus, Chasing Tyson, The Making of Triple G. I've got Athlete A, Last Dance, I Hate Christian Laettner, and Fantastic Lies. I've got one more pick. You've got two more.
Correct. I mean, I'm just going to stick with my theme here. UFC Fight Island Declassified.
Fight Island Declassified?
UFC Fight Island Declassified. If you weren't aware, last year we had a pandemic. And
really?
Yeah, I read that a couple of times. And there was nothing. There was no sports. Everything was shut down. UFC decided to try something different. They found an island. Big reveal here, they didn't find it. It actually was there already. Abu Dhabi, and because there no places allowed sports in America pretty much besides Florida, but they're not going to have a big arena for it. Was just pointless. So Abu Dhabi, and it was it's how the idea came. It's how all like the precaution, the ups and the downs of just trying to get it off the ground. Pretty much the first couple events, all the athletes like tested positive, what they're going to do, all the guys that got trapped. Even if you're not a fighting fan, it's a really cool thing.
This is one I need to watch because I honestly didn't know that it was in Abu Dhabi for the longest time. I thought it was just like off the coast of like California or something, or like off Florida or something. Like, I honestly just assumed it was like a U.S. island that Dana White like took over. Or like, I honestly had no clue where it was. I just was like, you hear like saw like Fight Island memes and stuff. That was pretty much the gist of what I knew, and I watched one or two fights from it. So this is definitely when I'd be interested, because I'm very curious as to how this all, and like you said, the first guys
tested. And it wasn't easy, man. Like, it's not like they were in talks with an island, got the deal, got all the guys over there, had a fight. Like, the amount of ups and downs that island had, and the amount of ups and downs, it was just crazy. I really recommend that one.
Yeah, where can you find that one?
It's on Hulu.
I'm gonna watch that one too. That sounds well. That one sounds real good.
I think it's 4 episodes. It's really cool. How they have to adjust almost on the spot, because next pay per view, the main event, the guy gets COVID. What are you gonna do? Like, flying Jorge Masvidal.
They should keep the two guys. They should find a ref that has COVID, and then just put two fighters. It doesn't matter weight class. That both have COVID, and just have them fight, and you just call it the COVID brawl or something.
Creative.
I think nobody loses. I mean, somebody does lose, but you know. My final pick, Catholic.
When you say that it doesn't matter the weight class, so can we have just like Henry Cejudo face like Francis Ngannou?
That would be pretty sick to see.
Both have COVID.
That would be kind of dope.
Would it?
I mean, I'd love to see Cejudo try to dodge Ngannou for 3, 4, 5 rounds and just try not to die.
I guess Cejudo in 2.
It's bold. It's bold.
Not Ngannou fan.
All right, my final pick, my last pick of the draft, number 9 overall. I am taking one. It's the University of Miami playing against Notre Dame. They're playing against Notre Dame. The Catholics versus Convicts game, one of the most famous college football games ever, like of all time. Notre Dame and Miami, sworn rivals, still to this day. And leading the year before, Miami beat the shit out of Notre Dame. Notre Dame was down. They just brought in Lou Holtz. Lou Holtz was trying to turn the program around. And they've got a gritty group. Chris Zorich, Todd Light. Chris Zorich, friend of the pod. He has been on also. He was a key factor in this game. He was the best defensive player in the Catholics versus Convicts game. So kind of getting him on, way back, I think it was episode 64, was like a dream come true, because I've watched this documentary maybe 100 times with my dad, and we are able to just – we still get amazed by some of the stuff we see. But so leading up to the game, Notre Dame and Miami are both undefeated. It's crazy. Nobody expected both teams to be undefeated when they're meeting. They're playing in South Bend in Notre Dame, home of the Irish. And there's these 2 or 3 students. They decide, like, let's start making T-shirts. They were making, like, ticket T-shirts. Like, oh, this is the ticket from when Notre Dame played Michigan. They'd sell those. There was so much copyright law that they were violating. It's ridiculous. And then they eventually made the very famous Catholics versus Convicts T-shirt. To talk about Notre Dame playing against Miami, who they pretty much marketed as a thug team. And those shirts, they said they printed them off in like 3 hours away in Michigan, and they drove and got them the morning of the game and literally sold out before the game even started. People were buying them like hotcakes. But a big thing was Notre Dame played a team and won to stand defeated. These two kids drove from Notre Dame to Michigan State, to East Lansing, where Miami was playing Michigan State, and they thought Miami was going to lose. And like, if they had lost, the game would have lost all its luster. And eventually Miami makes a comeback. One of the kids tosses one of the Catholics versus Convicts shirts down into the tunnel, and they're able to pretty much get it into the locker room for Miami to see, to pretty much make so much hype around this game. And Notre Dame, spoiler alert, ends up winning the game. There were some controversial calls, but it goes down as, there was a brawl before the game outside the tunnel, because Notre Dame only has one tunnel that you go in. So Miami had to pass by Notre Dame. And it was just the amount of NFL talent that played in that game, along with the storyline, is crazy. And it's crazy because the kid that made the shirts was trying to walk onto the basketball team. He eventually, because they told him to stop making the shirts, the Notre Dame administration, they were like, well, you didn't stop making the shirts, so you're not going to be able to walk onto the basketball team. So he loses pretty much that, and it's awesome documentary. Probably my all-time favorite. It's a classic.
This is a huge loss if you're just not able to walk onto a team. You're not that good, bro.
Yeah, it was like his dream.
Well, should have got a scholarship.
All right, what's your final pick?
She went D3.
Final pick here.
Final pick, we're going to bring it back to 5 sports movies, and I'm going to go with the documentary version of Foxcatcher.
Great.
We talked about on the last episode of Foxcatcher is about the murder of wrestler Dave Schultz. The documentary is a lot more. Have you seen the documentary?
I've seen bits and pieces, I think.
It's another one, I'm not comparing it to Last Dance at all, but it's a story how it's just hard to believe that it actually happened. And the dude is just John DuPont, the guy who assassinated Dave Schultz, is just a psychopath. Dude was like addicted by ego, addicted to just addicted to accomplishment, just addicted to the perception of being much bigger than what he is. Like he ran fake tournaments and ran fake matches in order for him, this old man who'd never wrestled a day in his life, to win.
That was the weirdest part of the movie. The first time I saw it, because I was a little bit younger, I really didn't understand it. I was like, why is he wrestling? Like, I didn't think he wrestled. I watched it a few more times. I understood it, but I'm like, that's just so odd.
It is odd. There's definitely some things going, some bolts are definitely loose up there. Some screws are loose.
You think?
Yeah, but it's kind of sad because even though he did a very tragic thing, he was addicted to feeling included, mm-hmm. and putting all that money into wrestling, which is odd also to begin with, because it's not like you ever wrestled. Putting all that money into wrestling and pretty much paying these people to be around you and be friendly to you, they unfortunately became almost like a second family who he became like addicted to. And anytime they left or they weren't around him so much, he was just depressed. Which I'm not trying to say like boo-hoo this guy, let's feel bad for him, but it's just kind of crazy to see how this guy actually was and some real life footage of him.
Is the Steve Carell character in the movie like a spot on representation of what he was?
Yes, I think so. I think they could have gone like a little more extreme with Carell.
Yeah. He seemed like a nut job though. It's crazy.
For sure. And then having like a standoff with the police in his mansion after killing the dude. It's wild.
I forgot about that part of it.
Yeah.
That's crazy. But so that'll wrap up the Doc's draft. I was thinking of throwing one. We've kind of done like a lot of media stuff, like music, movies, documentaries. Let's throw a random one in for next week that we'll do. And we're just going to go top 5 places to piss. So outside, porta potty. I think that could be a fun one to do.
Your number one's going to be New Jersey.
No. I have peed in many places. And I'm going to win this draft because I'm already thinking like I'm thinking of top, like I've got like 30 places. We go 30 picks in a row and I'm going to wall up this draft.
What is this? We're what?
Top 5 places to take a piss. Or like moments too.
Moments. Give me an example.
Road trip. You're like, you got to go. You end up pulling over and go. That's like a top piss moment. Like top moment where you're taking a piss.
It should be experience-wise. Like, your top 5 pisses that aren't in a bathroom.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. I'm not saying, like, bathroom. I'm saying, like, or you're driving with your buddies, and you're like, yo, I need you to pull over right now.
Yeah, pissed at a bottle of beer.
You hop outside of the road, and you go. Or you've had a couple beers, and you piss off, like, a balcony or something. Or, like, off a porch.
I pissed in a bottle at the airport.
I've done that as well. So save it. That's what we're going to do for our next draft.
Okay.
Do some homework. Think of good places you've gone number one.
I got a couple.
Anything else on your end? Oh, before I'm cutting you off after I asked, new JR Specs out. Grapevine. It came out in like a 3 package of Getcha Geek, Red Solo Funk, and the great new song Grapevine. And it's awesome. I kind of wish it came out earlier in the summer, because it's got like a real good summer vibe. But yeah, so go check that out if you haven't. It's just, he doesn't miss. He really doesn't miss. So it was awesome.
I went to a tourist store today, and a dude was like, the guy who worked there was saying like, he was trying to get people together, and $10 each, you get to visit the Jersey Shore house. I'm like, no, bro. they wanted a good place to piss.
Yeah, I wouldn't even piss there. It doesn't even deserve it. It's just so gross. Like, what a cesspool, like, which is what a shitty state you decided to live in. Oh my god.
Big reveal, her parents lived there. She was born there.
So Zoe was born in New Jersey, like in Jersey Shore?
Correct.
Oh, Brett. You might have to break up with her.
It's not on my agenda.
Brett. It's from the Jersey Shore.
From like the town over. But you can probably smell it.
You could definitely. I could smell the Jersey Shore from your house. You're like an hour and a half away.
Dude, I smell like salt right now.
Did you go in the water today?
Yeah, we were in the water.
You swim around, do a little doggy paddle?
Did not do that. It was just my feet. I was just wearing my shorts, like my cargo shorts.
That's good though.
Yeah.
That's good. We've got some water over on campus. We've got a beach on the bay side, and then we've got the canal that if you go in, you'll just get ripped to shreds.
So which one do you pick?
Sometimes I debate going in the canal. Sometimes I say, you know, maybe I can swim to the Cape. Cause it's literally not a far swim. Like if it was like the Connecticut River, like how the rapids aren't bad there, or like how the current's not bad there, I'd be perfectly fine. But the rapids would literally just tear you to shreds. So maybe if I go in the water, I go bayside because there's no current over there.
Maybe we have a pod and ask about the Jersey Shore. I'm pretty sure we're coming up to Connecticut in a couple of weeks.
Really?
Maybe.
Who is we, including Zoe?
That is the we. Might go up to the Big E or something.
Text me when you're up here, depending what weekend.
I will. Well, next week I'm in Dallas. So.
Oh, I forgot you're going to Dallas. Oh, talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, so next Friday I head out to Who's Number One. I got a couple of my Jersey guys that I film a lot of. That sounds weird.
Especially since they're like not in high school either.
They're in high school now. Leo started Blair.
They're freshmen in high school. They're not eighth graders anymore.
Correct. Thank you. Put some respect on their name. Both Leo and Knox, a couple guys who I do a lot of film work with, are having the opportunity to wrestle in Who's Number One. So they can keep their title or gain their title as number one wrestler in the country. Events put on by Flow Sports. It's gonna be good. I leave.
How was it having Flow at Rhino?
It was good. It was good because it was just Mike Mal and David Bray, and I like Mike Mal a lot.
So. You and your good buddy Mike Mal.
I wouldn't go that far. I was with him a couple of days. When did we record last?
We recorded like Wednesday or Thursday, I think.
I was there on Sunday. I was there Labor Day. I was there Monday. I was filming a practice that he wanted to run, so we got some stuff.
That's pretty good. Well, I mean, you and Mike Mal went to dinner, so I would say you and your best friend Mike Mal.
I mean, he's the one who got me when I went to the Princeton Iowa duel. When you got me that hookup, and then he got me the WA pass too.
You could call yourself like pretty much brothers at this point. Like you guys are that close.
Yeah, blood brothers, give or take.
You guys do a blood oath together?
Yeah, behind closed doors.
I respect it.
Appreciate it. Dude, his son is taller than me. He's 13 years old.
Wow. Who Mal's son is?
Yeah, Mike Mal's like my height.
That's where does this kid wrestle? Where is he like? Where does he live? Is he from Jersey, or like, does he live in Jersey?
No, he's in Austin with Mike.
Is that where Flo is?
Yeah,
that makes sense.
I'd assume that he's definitely born in Jersey. His son,
big time wrestling guy.
Who, his son or Mike?
Mike Mal, all time. Well, for football, you always, like, with football, there's guys that are, like, football guys.
Yeah.
And, like, that's, like, a gritty guy. I feel like wrestling's probably the same. Like, you're pretty gritty, yucked character. That would be – Mike Mal would be a wrestling guy, they'd call him. He would be a football guy if he played football. But he's definitely a wrestling guy.
Yeah, the difference between football guys and wrestling guys is most football guys played football. No, vice versa. Sorry. A lot of – all wrestling guys, for the most part, wrestled. A lot of football guys, I feel like some of them didn't play football. Like, I feel like from media to some coaches, they just played, like, the bare minimum.
They played, like, high school ball or something.
Correct.
Yeah. Like, I don't think, like, unless I'm wrong, I don't think, like, Todd McShay or, like, Adam Schefter played college football. Unless I'm, like, completely wrong. But, yes, I agree with that. I think the majority of guys you see in media nowadays are definitely, for wrestling, are all former college, like, wrestlers.
Yeah.
What about the guy with the mole on his face from Big Tens and Triller? You think he wrestled in college?
I have no idea how he's managed to stay together so long. He looks like one of those guys that if he looks at a sport, he's going to crumble into pieces. So
he's an odd guy. I hope I never. Oh,
he's a dork. Oh, we're going to talk about Trump commentator.
I was just going to bring that up talking about Triller. Yeah. It's kind of funny. It's him and
Trump. It's hilarious, dude.
It's Trump and Trump Jr. And I think Trump Jr., I've listened to him on a few podcasts, and he's got a good sense of humor. I think Trump will just be pure comedy because, like, he's just going to be like, I like both fighters. Both fighters are very good. They're very good.
He knows his stuff. Like, he is a fighting fan, but
he's in the WWE Hall of Fame.
Yeah, you're right. After Bobby Lashley defeated Umaga. Correct.
Him and Snoop Dogg, are they've reached the pinnacle.
Yeah, more celebrities than that. It's insane. It's just so funny to think. Former president, not just any president, the fucking Cheeto man, just commentating a Vitor, even the fight itself. Why Vitor Belfort versus Evander Holyfield with Donald Trump commentating? Looking at that 5 years ago, you would think it's ludicrous. Like, it's insane. It's so funny.
Well, I mean, Trump running for president a few years ago seemed like it was very ludicrous. So now anything he does, I'm just not very shocked. I'm just kind of like, yeah, I mean,
dude, but it makes sense, like him attending a boxing fight. That's funny in itself. Like a former president showing up to a fight. That's kind of funny. Mm-hmm. Literally commentating a fight that could well over get like 750,000 pay-per-view buys. That's so funny.
Yeah, it's. I think it's gonna be pure comedy. I'm kind of excited to just
see. Yeah, I can't wait to legally stream the Thriller fight.
That's the one thing that it makes me nervous is the Triller fight. I hate the Triller fights.
Yeah, that's why I'm, yeah. Asker is my last one buying.
Ugh. Don't remind. He out of sight, out of mind.
But I feel less bad about it after Jake Paul beat Tyron Woodley, so.
Yeah. But I don't have anything else, you?
No, I need aloe on my face.
Yeah, go get unburnt. Before I let you guys go, Mass Maritime takes on SUNY Friday. Big game, opening the season. I don't know if SUNY won or lost or if they even played week one. Doesn't matter. We're playing that school down south. I'm fired up about it. The Bucks are fired up about it. So I don't know if you guys can stream it. Go to maybe like the Mass Maritime website. And you could probably stream the game if you want to. If not, that's no skin off my back or no skin off my sack, I guess. I don't know if that's your expression, but other than that, what was that you pulled out the pocket?
A seashell.
Pretty sick. Souvenir.
So much sand in my pocket.
Thank you guys for listening to this episode of the My Parents Office podcast. Next week, we've got the top five places to pee draft or your top five. Yeah, we'll go with that. And I think JR Specs will be on the show too. So stay tuned for that. And thanks for listening, guys. Bye.